Okay, I'll start from here. Okay, so the question is that when you are 12,800 kilometers above the surface of the Earth, and therefore twice the radius of the Earth distance, twice the radius of the Earth distance from the center of mass of the Earth, then what will happen to the gravitational force? Maybe you can just say what will happen to the gravitational force, that's all. All of you can see two responses that have come. We'll just work with these two responses. Most of your responses would fall into these categories. One student says it will reduce in half, and another says it will go down. Okay. Now this is an interesting situation. Okay, to examine something. Which of these two statements is the more general statement? It will reduce in half, or it will go down? First one or the second one? Which is a more general statement? Yeah, it will go down. The second statement is the more general statement. The first one might be more accurate, provided it has been worked out. Yeah, that means that the first statement could be the more accurate answer. It sounds like it. It's better to say it will go down by half than to say it will go down if you think of it in terms of specifics, right? But that would be valid only if it is something that has been mathematically worked out, because you're making a mathematical statement when you say that the force is going to halve itself, right? So I'd like to ask the student who said it will reduce in half, is there any reason why you say it will reduce in half? So, Ratul, you suggested that it would reduce in half. Would you like to change your statement, or would you like to stand by it and give me an argument why? I'd much rather you give an argument why, and because it will help to illustrate something. Why did you think it will go down by a factor of 2? You can also verbally reply if it is difficult to type things down. Okay, Sumit just got logged out and logged in. So nothing much happened. I was just saying that when the object is at 12,800 kilometers from the center of mass of the Earth, a 40 kilogram object, would the force of gravity acting on it, that is its weight, would it redu what would happen to it? So people suggested that the weight will go down. Somebody suggested the weight will become half. The force would become half. So I asked, what is the more general statement out of these two? And people, of course, recognize that it will go down is a more general statement, and it will become half is a very specific statement, and it is mathematically tied. That means that there is a mathematical analysis behind that answer. So I was just suggesting, asking Ratul, who made the suggestion that it will go down in half, could you argue why you said half specifically? Because there is something that can be illustrated by that. Ratul, would you like to say something? So Ratul has responded. I'll just read out his response. As g goes down with distance increasing, therefore as distance doubles, the pull reduces by half. So see, quantitatively, our mind works in a certain way. Okay, so if you say that I doubled the distance, and you have an understanding that the force actually reduces, the proportion by which it reduces must be the proportion by which the distance increases, right? So therefore, automatically, almost unconsciously, for those of us who do think mathematically, the number half immediately comes in. Okay. And that is where we got to pause a little bit and look more carefully at the equation, because as it turns out, it doesn't go down by half. Okay. Now the question is, by how much then does it go out, and how do we know this? Okay. We'd either have to perform the experiment and check it out, which is not possible within the realm of which we are working. It is beyond the scope of what we are trying to do over here. But a mathematical analysis, however, is perfectly possible. And we don't need to do complex mathematics. Just an algebraic analysis would be sufficient to tell us actually by how much the number changes. So here is what we can do. We can compare the situation at this point, okay, which is r distance away from the Earth, and at this point, which is 2 times r distance away from the Earth. Okay, how do we do that? We do that by employing the equation. Okay, and then you are already thinking, oh my God, it was hard enough trying to do the calculation with m1 being 1 kilogram and m2 being the mass of the Earth and the radius being as large as 6,400 kilometers. Now we have to compare it with 40 kilograms, the mass of the Earth, and the radius changing from 6,400 kilometers to 12,800 kilometers. And on top of that, we have the value of g. But you don't have to go that far because we have a method of manipulating it algebraically in such a way that you can actually eliminate most of the values from the equation. And I will show you how. So the force at the point, at the distance r, is given by the equation g m1 m2. And I can change this to the mass m, that is u, your mass, this one, and the m2 as being the mass of the Earth. Okay, I hope that is clear. Divided by the radius of the Earth square. Okay, so this is at the distance r. What about the distance 2r? Well, it's going to be g m, mass of the Earth, divided by r, 2 times the diameter. How do I show this over here? I can show it as 2r of Earth whole square. Any problem with these two equations? So this is at the distance r, the force experienced by the 40 kilogram person, and this is the force at 2 times r experienced by the 40 kilogram person. Is there any problem with that? Should I re-explain anything? Okay, so just to sort of recap on that, I made a comparison on the forces, the force at r and the force at 2r, and then since I am dividing the two LHSs, I can also divide the two RHSs, and yes, so you can see that a lot of things are going to get cancelled out. And just for the just to be clear about it, so that I don't miss any steps in between, I'm just going to take this part and I'm going to expand it over here. I'm going to get g m m e by r e square times 2 r e whole squared divided by g m m a. So you see, all of this is just going to divide itself out. Right? So I didn't have to do any substitutions. I didn't have to do any complicated calculations. I simply canceled the whole thing out. And what I am left with now is just going to be, I'm running out of space here. And I want to keep this. Okay, maybe I can erase the top part over here. I'm going to write the ratio between FR, the force at R, and the force at 2R is therefore going to be 2 times R of E the whole squared, okay, which gives me 4 R E squared. So the expansion of this is this. I'm just sliding it a little down so you can see the top, okay, divided by R E the whole square. So the only bit that was left, which you might have thought, oh God, I have to work with the radius now. Okay, it's better than working with the masses, but radius is still going to be a problem. Even that gets wiped out because these two divide to one, right? So what you're left with now, very interestingly, is the ratio between these two, the force of gravity between these two distances is 4:1. Okay, and now do you realize why I went with 400 newtons and 40 kilograms over here? It's very nice to teach this to class 8 students because a lot of them are in that weight category, so they can kind of relate with this easily. Okay, which is that. Now again, we have to still be careful. We have to proceed with some care over here. So the question is now, will you be heavier here or here? Okay, will you be heavier at R or will you be heavier at 2R? Heavier yati, when you go further away, the attraction reduces. The attraction reduces, so you're going to be lighter. So you're going to be happier with your own weight the higher you go. That was just an adult way of looking at it. I suppose children sometimes might feel happier to see that their weight is increasing. I remember when I was a teenager, my weight was like stuck at something like 27 or 28 for a couple of years. And I was like, when am I going to increase my weight? Of course, as an adult, I feel the reverse now. But anyway, so therefore, you are going to be heavier at R than at 2R. So a person who weighs 400 newtons on the surface of the earth, right? What will his weight be at that point, at the distance 2R?
Arun sir?
Yeah.
Sorry, I didn't get the explanation of why.
Yeah.
You will be heavier. Your weight will be heavier for 2R.
Not heavier. It will be what it is. So right now, if you are 40 kilograms, then your weight is 400 newtons, according to physics. Of course, your mass is 40 kilograms. Okay, but the force with which Earth attracts you will be 400 newtons. Okay. So I shouldn't have said where will you be heavier. It is in comparison, where will you be heavier at R or at 2R? So when I say that, is it confusing? You obviously are going to be heavier at R because the force of attraction is greater there. If you go to 12,800 kilometers from the Earth, that is 6,400 kilometers above the surface, just imagine wherever you are, you suddenly shot up 6,400 kilometers up into space. Okay, and from that distance, you're looking at the beautiful Earth, the blue planet, the blue marble, right? And you're wondering, what is the force with which the Earth is pulling me down? And it's going to be 1/4 of whatever it was on the surface. So that is what the mathematics tells us. Is that clear now, Bhavya? Or is there any other specific question that you would like?
Yeah, it's clear. It's clear. Yeah.
So I should have said, in comparison to where? So I shouldn't simply say, are you going to be heavier on the surface? Are you going to be heavier on the surface or are you going to be heavier at 2R? Heavier in the sense of gravitational attraction. Your mass will of course remain the same. Okay. So therefore, what we can see is that if it is twice the distance from the center of mass of the Earth, the weight or the gravitational force becomes 1/4. Okay, not half. That's interesting. All right. What if it is 3 times R? What if you got this far from the Earth? Right. So now what would that distance be? It would be at this point 3 times R. Okay. So without even doing the mathematics, those of who are of that analytical bent, yes, can immediately say that Look, it's going to be 1/9. Okay, and why 1/9? Neeraj, could you explain why you, because you suggested it'll be 1/9 of your weight. Can you, in your own words, explain why you thought so? Yeah, Neeraj, go ahead.
So I again thought of this formula, and instead of 2, I put 3. So yeah. That brought me to 1, yeah. Yeah. 3 RE square.
Correct. Over here, for example.
Yeah.
So if you go over here, instead of the 2 RE square over here, if you are at that point, this will become 3 RE square, right? And 3 square will be 9. So the number there will be 9. And if that is 9, then the ratio is going to be 9 times as much, which means at the surface, you are going to be having 9 times of whatever it is that you are having there, which means that the force of gravitation at 3 times R from the center of gravity of the Earth is going to be 1/9 of what it is at the surface. So what will be, whatever will be 400 divided by 9, can somebody work that out and tell me? It will be something like 40 point something, right? Okay, I'll do it myself. Can you see something on my phone? No, nothing is visible. That's strange, huh? The camera is not picking up because the refresh rate is so slow, or maybe the refresh rate of the camera and the refresh rate of the of the mobile phone is exactly the same, so it's not able to see what is going on. Ah, Neeraj got, okay. So that's 44.44 newtons. Okay. So if you are over here now, just to put the numbers in, so if you are 400 newtons out here, you're going to be 100 newtons out here, and out here you're only going to be 44.4 newtons in terms of weight. Okay, so it's going to be a lot easier to handle you in any of these rows. So if two of you happen to be up there, you could very easily pull, lift, push, etc., each other when you are up there than when you are down here. And this is the same with anybody who's played around in a swimming pool. I used to have fun lifting my dad up. My dad is a pretty huge guy. I used to have fun lifting him up in the swimming pool. There's no other place that I could lift him up, but I would tell him, I want to pick you up in the swimming pool. We'll go inside, and then I'll carry him in my hands. I feel strong about it. And that's because of the buoyancy, your weight goes down. So similarly, out there in space, your weight goes down. Somebody who weighs 40 kilograms, who wouldn't be anyway easy, difficult to lift in any case, would just be weighing something like the equivalent of 4.5 kilograms. Okay. So therefore, the inverse square law. So that is where the question of the inverse square law comes. Yeah, Sumedh, I'll just answer your question in a moment. Let me just tie this up, which is that this brings us to the law. It's not really a law. It's like a mathematically understandable statement, which is that because there is a square at the denominator of this equation on the RHS, whatever the radius over here, if it is 2 times of r, 3 times of r, 4 times of r, 5 times of r, that you call it the abscissa or the mantissa, I don't remember the number that comes over here, okay, the that fixed quantity is also going to be squared along with the actual radius. So therefore, whatever the force, it will fall by the square of that the factor by which you are multiplying the radius. So therefore, this law or this understanding of it is called as the inverse square law. So at 2 times r, it's going to be 1/4. At 3 times r, it's going to be 1/9. At 4 times r, it's going to be 1/16. At 5 times r, it's going to be 1/25, and so on and so forth. And the reason why the inverse square law is important is because pretty much in every major area of physics that you study, this is classical mechanics, you might study wave equations next, you might study electricity and magnetism next. These square laws come into play over there. So it's a good thing to understand how the square law works, particularly if it is in the inverse, that means it is in the denominator position, then the forces fall off at the rate of 1/4, 1/9, 1/16, 1/25th, which is, yes, similar to kinetic energy also, which is also non-intuitive, right? So you think that generally speaking, if you double the distance, the force should reduce by half, but it is not so. If you want to know specifically how the force falls off, you have to look at the equation, and if there is a square or sometimes even a cube, as in the case of magnetism, then you know that the forces fall off very, very quickly. Okay, the forces reduce by a very large margin as you start going further and further away. The relationship is not linear. Okay, so this is the main point that I wanted to drive home today, and I think we can stop now.